Well, thank you very much, Bettina, and thank you to all of you. You have gotten the school year off to, I think, a really, really great start. It seems to me it's been very, very smooth. Like many of you, I had the opportunity to attend the Village Schools Back to School Night last night. I thought it was absolutely wonderful. I was fascinated. I won't exactly say that I wish I had village children again, but at any rate, it was wonderful. And thanks, of course, to the CPA for the wonderful work that you all do. Of course, the $205,000 is pretty stunning, but really much more than that is all the effort that goes into making this a true school community that encompasses not only 830 students, but an awful lot of very caring and intelligent adults. They always say you should talk about what you love, so I was looking back. This is actually the 16th time I've had the honor of addressing the CPA brunch. And so I looked back at things that I talked about before, and I found that back in 2003, I had talked about what I love about Chadwick. And I thought, well, now there's a good topic. And every decade or so, I should probably revisit that. I think 10 years is probably not too short of a time. So at any rate, I thought I would talk about some of the things that I really love about Chadwick School. And of course, I do have the perspective not only as the headmaster, but as somebody who's had kids here for quite a while. And I'm just going to, you know, you've been here sitting for a long time, so I'm only going to mention a few things. So there's a lot more that I could go on and keep you here through the whole weekend about what I love about the school. But as I look back at what I said in 2003, the number one thing is still the number one thing, and that's our students. Our students are amazing. They are friendly. They are warm. They are kind. They are open, they are incredibly hardworking, they are unpretentious, they are extremely humble, given all of the things that they actually accomplish. They represent the school amazingly well in every venue. I think those of you who have seen the Admirals talk, there's a reason why the Admirals represent the school in admissions events as opposed to people like me. It's because they're so well-spoken. We don't ever prep them. We don't ever give them any sort of preview of coming events. They just say whatever comes to their mind. And any of us who have been in a situation where somebody's asking us questions, we're standing in front of a group of people, that's not a comfortable situation to be in necessarily. And the Admirals do an amazing job because of who they are. Down at the village level, we always, whenever our kids go out on field trips, we always get positive reports back from wherever they happen to go as how well-behaved they are, how thoughtful they are. Whenever there's a guest speaker, the speaker always says, they're so attentive, they ask great questions. I would have to say the student body was one of the main reasons that we were here. When we were originally interviewed, our daughter Emma was so little that she was in one of those car carriers that you can also take out and stick under the table. She actually sat through a dinner with some trustees under the table. But at any rate, and our older daughter, I think, must have been four. And the school very wisely, because of all the dinners we had to go to in the search process, they assigned us two Chadwick seniors, Jenny Prakash and Piper Legrelius, to be our babysitters. And we were very demanding parents with regard to babysitters. So they gave us these two girls, these two seniors, and literally they blew us away to the point where we actually let them drive our kids to Chuck E. Cheese's. Well, what a bonus that was, we didn't appreciate until later. But at any rate, just to give you a point of reference, we didn't allow my parents to drive our children. But at any rate, I still remember standing in the hotel room where we were staying the first night, and Amy and I looking at each other and going, if our daughters turn out to be anything like Jenny and Piper, we will have hit a home run. This must be an amazing place if this is the kind of student that is coming out of here. And of course, it is. So that's number one, is our students. And I'd say right behind it now with the daughter who's graduated from here, I'd say our alumni. I had a wonderful experience a couple of weeks ago, the first week of school. I took a walk down around the athletics to see how the teams were doing. They're all practicing. So I went in the gym, and there's Nikki Lane, who graduated from here a few years ago, helping out with the volleyball team. Just an outstanding person. I look out on the field. There's Garrett Wymore. I coached him when he was starting in eighth grade. You know, just graduated from Dartmouth, was probably the most highly decorated athlete at Dartmouth, was one of five kids picked to lead the procession at Dartmouth for graduation. He's out there helping the football team. And then I go over to the pool, and there's Nick Herzig, who graduated from here and is now an eighth grade science teacher and is a water polo. And there's not a finer person that's graduated from Chadwick, at least in my time. Not only an outstanding student, but also a great athlete, always into performing arts and just a wonderful, wonderful person. I thought, how great is this? That our recent alumni are back passing on sort of the Chadwick way, the Chadwick tradition, the Chadwick expectations to our students. And I know that from having daughters here that, you know, there's an old expression that you send your child to the schoolmaster, but it's his classmates who educate him. That is definitely true at Chadwick. One of the most powerful educative forces in the school is the student body. I know our daughters have been carried along to do things and to get into things and to try things and to set expectations that they would have never had if it weren't for the positive peer pressure of the kids that they're with. And now that I see our older daughters' classmates coming rolling back from college and I hear all the things that they are doing, I realize that they've really been set up for a lifetime of expecting to get involved, to do things, to make a difference, not just in the classroom, but outside of the classroom. It is phenomenal, and they do it with a smile, and they do it as if it's no big deal. So I would add to our students, now I have the opportunity to know some of our young alumni. A second group, of course, is you all. You know, getting to know our parents as a parent has been a wonderful, amazing, and I must say, not fully anticipated joy. Of course, we didn't realize what kind of group we were getting into. But you all help us not only through the parent organizations, but through supporting the principals and the philosophy of the school. We know that in this area, people have lots of educational options for their kids, and some of them are completely free. And so for our parents to think about sending their kids to Chadwick and to make that commitment means that they really do understand and support the philosophy and the principles of the school. You take care of all the kids. Not just your own kids, everybody's kids. That sets an amazing example for all of our students, the way that Chadwick parents reach out and help other people. I had forgotten about this, but when I talked about it in 2003, we had just started the carpooling program that, you know, now it's sort of old, you know, old news. Everybody's used to it. But there was a day when you didn't have to carpool, believe it or not. And the way that you all have supported it, you way exceeded the county's requirement for carpooling. And now it's really just something that everybody does. That's a hugely supportive thing and obviously sets a very good example. And let's face it, we know that the wonderful kids that I was talking about, we know where they come from. It's because of you. So while we get the chance to work with them from ages 5 to 18, we know where 90%+ of that came from. It came from the example that you're setting in your homes. So you're both directly and indirectly supporting the best things about the school. Of course, a third group that's I you know, dearly love are the teachers and administrators at the school. And the thing that I really admire is that they do deeply care about every student. And there's a school in Boston, Roxbury Latin, where they have a saying that it's where every, it's a school for boys. They say where every boy is known and loved. And I truly believe that to be the case at Chadwick. Not every teacher knows deeply every student, but every student is known deeply by at least someone. And sitting in the roll calls and listening in the faculty meetings, that love comes through. I see it every day. And that's really the most important thing to me, both as a headmaster and a parent, is that our faculty cares about the students. Yes, they care about chemistry. Yes, they care about mathematics, but they really need to care about and love the students first. And I feel we're blessed to have a faculty and staff that do. The fourth thing is, of course, I love the fact that we were founded by Margaret Chadwick. I mean, what an amazing, inspirational woman. The fact that she titled her book about the founding of the school, A Dipper Full of Humanity, to reference the fact that one of the most important things about the school is that it is diverse, that we're going to have kids from all different kinds of backgrounds and that we're going to learn from each other, was amazing when you realize how long ago she said it. The fact that she said that the purpose of the school was to habituate children to ways of living that are productive and worthwhile, as opposed to simply prepare them. That's a huge philosophical idea, which means that they should do today what it is we want them to do tomorrow. That the whole thing isn't front-loaded into preparation, and then eventually you get to do something. It means that starting the first day of kindergarten, we have ways of doing things that you are going to get in the habit of doing, so it becomes a habit. The fact that she was such a proponent of experiential education obviously has a huge effect on the way we go about doing what we're doing. And of course, her global view. If you think about the fact that if Margaret Chadwick hadn't set out to travel around the world as a single woman in 1928, her first stop was China. That's where she met her husband. So no trip to China no meeting Joe Chadwick, no Chadwick children, no homeschool, no Chadwick school. I mean, if you think about it, this is where the school's roots came from. And one of my favorite quotations from Mrs. Chadwick is this: a strong feeling of belonging to each other and of belonging to the whole family of man develops. And once a child has grasped the concept of we, as meaning old and young, rich and poor, of every color and of all nations, he has found himself at home in the world. She said that in 1963. That's an amazing, inspiring concept today that obviously the school is striving mightily to live out. A fifth thing I love about the school are the way that we have found language to express what we really care about. The core values, the honor code, and now, as Deb talked about, the core competencies. Prior to my coming to Chadwick, the school community, the faculty, staff, and parent body had worked together to develop the core values. In my first year, we had the opportunity to basically to publicize them and to really start to work on them. And they have been very, very powerful. I remember our accreditation visit a few years ago, Mark Hobart, who was the head of St. Margaret's School down in San Juan Capistrano, made the comment, he was part of the visiting team, and he said, Chadwick School is a school that seeks the truth and speaks the truth. And I thought, boy, if we live up to that, we have that is an incredible statement and very, very humbling. And our core values really work. I'll give you two examples from just the first couple weeks of school. So the second week of school, we had an impromptu fire drill. This was occasioned by a kindergartner wondering what the heck the fire alarm thing was and pushing it. So, any rate, next day, he comes to my office with the teacher. And so we have a sit down, and we talk about responsibility and the fact that he was taking responsibility and what a wonderful thing that was. And then we talked about honesty and how amazing it is that he came forward with the truth and told the whole story. And there it was, and he got it. He got the whole thing. And then, of course, we did talk about fire alarms and what they're for and how if you push it, 900 people drop what they're doing and go to the baseball field. We begin to consider maybe they ought to be a little higher on the wall. Maybe he should tell his buddies. But anyway, it was wonderful that that's what we were talking about, and that I was able to compliment him on two of the three things, the two really big things, honesty and responsibility, which was fantastic. I mean, that was a great outcome. And then from the other end of the spectrum, I'd like to share with you Blair Horner, who's the Honor Council co-chair this year as a 12th grader. He gave a speech a couple of weeks ago about the honor code, and I'd just like to share part of it with you, and we're going to put it on the website. But this shows you, so you've got the kindergartner, and now you've got the 12th grader. And here's part of what Blair said. Why Chadwick? What makes us so unique? Is it where we are or who we are? What is it that makes Chadwick iconic? After all, we're not only locally recognized as having one of the best high school curriculums and educations, Chadwick's reputation is global. We extend our reach and influence overseas into South Korea as Chadwick International breaks barriers in the realm of international education. Our students every year go out into the world and actually affect it. As I talk about Chadwick's global sphere of influence, I can't help but think back to our own Chadwick home, the main lawn, Rossler, the entrance gates. Even more so, I think of the roots of Chadwick, Margaret Chadwick's home school for boys and girls. Mrs. Chadwick started such a simple thing, a place where a couple of kids could go to think on their own and develop as individuals, yet she affected her students' lives in a worldly way. Chadwick students' perspectives continue to be broadened as our school teaches us to understand others, think critically, and communicate with others. Chadwick allows us to develop character. Right now, your reach as an individual, our influence as a community, is being shaped and developed, so once you leave Chadwick, you can actually affect the world around you. For the school to be open for 78 years is an accomplishment. The Honor Code continues on the near century of Chadwick tradition of providing the world community with intelligent and compassionate people. What I challenge you to do this year as a freshman or a sophomore, junior or senior, is not only to consider how your actions and decisions affect the Chadwick community now, but to carry on Chadwick's iconic legacy of integrity that was founded long before today. Now that's remarkable. I mean, that's remarkable for an 18-year-old to stand up in front of the entire student body and faculty and say that. And that's only part of what Blair said. But that's where we're headed. and you know why I love the kids and why I love the fact that we have an honor code and a core values, because it really makes a powerful difference. And I would encourage you to go on the website and take a look at what the full speech that Blair gave. The core competencies I was going to talk about, but in fact Deb already touched on them. I will say that with all the talk about 21st century skills, that's been going on for a long time, basically what we wanted to do was to get real clear about what students need to master and develop over the course of sometimes a 13-year career at Chadwick. And I will just read you a quote from Tough Choices or Tough Times, which is the report from the new Commission on the Skills of the American Workforce. Obviously, we're a liberal arts school. We're not simply a vocational school training people for the workplace, but the fact of the matter is that what we need as people in the 21st century is pretty much what our kids are going to need to be productive citizens and workers. Yeah, so it is not irrelevant what these people had to say. This is from the National Center on Education and the Economy. I just quote, "It depends upon a deep vein of creativity that is constantly renewing itself. This is a world in which a comfort with ideas and abstractions is the passport to a good job, in which creativity and innovation are the key to the good life, in which high levels of education, a very different kind of education than most of us have had, are going to be the only security there is. A world in which routine work is largely done by machines is a world in which mathematical reasoning will be no less important than math facts, in which software engineers who are also artists and musicians will have an edge over those who are not." So as you hear us talking about where the school is going and why we're doing what we're doing and talking about the core competencies and changes in the math program and all of those kinds of things, it is heading towards this future for our students, preparing them for their future, not our past. And I'm very pleased that finally the standardized testing industry is starting to move in this direction. You've probably heard that there's going to be a new SAT, which is actually going to be ask kids to demonstrate the skills that they were taught in the classroom. And the heart of it is going to be analyzing evidence, something Chadwick students are quite good at. And of course, now the ACT has overtaken the SAT. There's more kids taking the ACT than the SAT. The ACT too will change. There'll be more free response questions, more asking kids to explain and predict. Again, thinking outside the box. And of course, tests for non-cognitive factors are being developed as well. A sixth thing I love is our campus. It's serene, it's safe, it's inspiring. I've had the opportunity not only to work there, but for 14 years, my family lived there. Mrs. Chadwick said, "Providing an environment that surrounds the child with beauty, that stirs his imagination, and affords an opportunity for meditation is of great importance." A few years ago, we did a new master plan for the campus, and it was led by Bill Fain, who's an absolutely world-class master planner and had grown up, actually, in Palos Verdes, right next door to the Chadwicks, once they moved off campus. So it was really interesting. He interviewed us when we interviewed him. He said, "Well, I looked at your website, and I saw your mission, and I looked at Harvard Westlake's, Pasadena Poly's, et cetera, and yours is different. It talks about the whole child. Is that true?" And we said, "Yes, that is true." And he said, "Then I'll do it." He said, "Because that's what Mrs. Chadwick was all about. And if you guys had moved off of that, I wouldn't be so interested." But anyway, one of the things that Bill did when he came onto campus to kind of get the lay of the land was he walked around the campus and he wanted to see the original buildings and the original blueprints. And then, this was on a Saturday morning, and then we went into Christensen Hall. Has everybody here been in Christensen where the food service is? Okay, that's one of the original buildings. And he said, "Okay, here is the expression of Mrs. Chadwick's philosophy in architecture." He said, "You start in this room that has the slope ceiling like this, that is small in size, that's like your living room. It has a hardwood floor, it has a fireplace. It makes the child feel at home and secure and safe. And then it opens to French doors that invite you outside and to a porch that invites you outside. And then it opens to the vista of Los Angeles and the world." He said that was her vision. To have you feel comfortable and safe as a young person, but to lead you out into the world to make a difference. And it was expressed in architecture on the campus. So the master plan going forward is going to have those same kinds of concepts. You've probably seen the Ansel Adams photos of the school from when Ansel Adams was our first school photographer, essentially. And he took some amazing pictures, but they're inspiring. And I think our campus is as inspiring today as it was when Mrs. Chadwick brought the school up here in 1937. We've got a few more buildings, but the key elements, the serenity, the natural beauty, the importance of outdoor space, the topography are all the same. And as much as I love our campus, I also love the fact that we have a second campus in South Korea. I think Chadwick International is going to be more and more a big, big part of Chadwick School Palos Verdes. We started out with a concept that it was one school, two campuses, and then John Jenner, upon his arrival this year, said, I think it should be one school, two campuses, many voices. And that's a really important component to it, because that is the idea that resonates with Mrs. Chadwick's idea about a dipper full of humanity. That our goal was not to take the Chadwick program and impose it in South Korea. It was, in fact, to build a whole other school built on the same principles, but where there would be ongoing dialogue between the two schools so that we would move forward. The image in my mind was basically like our seventh grade kids rock climbing at Joshua Tree, where first the left hand goes up and then the right hand goes up, and that's how the body gets up. It was never that we were going to cook it up in our kitchen like McDonald's and ship it to South Korea. And as you may or may not know, Chadwick International has been a tremendous success. After only 3 years, we have 774 students in grades pre-K through 10. We were named over the summer by the Korea Herald as the most beloved brand in Korea amongst international schools. We have now joined the top athletic conference among the schools. We won the first ever Korean national championship in robotics last year. We have an outstanding faculty and staff. We have great kids. I was thinking about what it, for those, I was going to show a slideshow, but I knew that it was going to be, we were going to be pressed for time, but we will put some video on the website. I would encourage you to look at it because, you know, it's an experience. It's hard to write a book about an experience. You have to experience it. But just to give you I was there right before school opened here. It was a good time for me to go because, you know, everybody was just sort of getting ready here. So I went over there and three things stood out to me that just kind of summarized. Well, first of all, when you walk in, the kids are, they could be Chadwick kids. They are Chadwick kids, sorry. They could be PV kids, excuse me. But anyway, the excitement, the enthusiasm, the warmth, the unfettered freedom is just as prevalent there as it is on our campus. You walk in and you see these huge banners that say Chadwick School and Chadwick International. You see all the core values everywhere. You see student work everywhere. But three things stood out to me. So one was, I got to listen to the ninth grade student council speeches. First of all, unbelievably articulate, incredibly good English, really deep thinkers, and the theme that kept coming through was, we want to make this the best school in the world. And that was not an arrogant statement, that was a statement of actually, that is what we, the student body, want to do, and we think we can do it. What a wonderfully powerful idea that is. And these are great kids. The second thing that I participated in is they have a house system, earth, air, water, fire, and everybody pre-K through 10 is in a house. So all the people are together. And so on Friday afternoon, they had this event where they all have different colors and shirts. And they're walking around the track. And so all the little tiny people had 10th graders, which is the oldest kids, who were their buddies. And they're holding their hands walking around the track. Now, anybody who's seen the Chadwick Wows, give the Beanie Babies, the seniors give the Beanie Babies to the kindergartners here, knows what I'm talking about. It's that feeling of reaching out across the ages. And those little guys, like sometimes their shoe would come untied. It was great to see the 10th graders lean down, tie their shoe, help them along, and they did not leave them until every one of them was where he or she needed to go. That was fantastic. And then the third thing that just, I don't know why, maybe it's because I'm, you know, love athletics, but I watched volleyball practice. And at the end of volleyball practice, they all bring it in and they go, wick on three, go wick. That's what all the Chadwick teams in PV do. I mean, it was just like nothing. And of course, they have more Chadwick swag than anybody. But at any rate, what's going on over there is amazing, because one of the things that we were concerned about was how can we really take this culture that's so important at Chadwick School in Palos Verdes and have it recreated in any real way in South Korea. And the fact of the matter is, it has been. And I'm really happy that our CIPA parents are here today. It's amazing for them to sacrifice to come over here. But just the same foundations that make this place go are what make that place go. You think about parents who take their most prized possession, their kids, and put it in a school that has never graduated anybody. And that is a very different model from the national prevailing culture of education, but they see that this is something they think of what could be, and they take the chance. And here we are 774 students later. I mean, it's phenomenal. after only 3 years and to have such a great reputation and have such an incredible program over there. And it's built on the Chadwick program, outdoor education, community service, athletics, performing arts, all of those things that we think are so important to a holistic education, they are running a full tilt over there. So what you may ask, why did we do this? So I'll just tell you very briefly, because I've heard everything from I don't know anything about it to I don't know why you guys always talk about CI so much. So I thought, well, I'd try to hit sort of in the middle of the fairway and give you some idea. First of all, it's our mission. I mean, one of our trustees said in June, I thought he summed it up very nicely. He said, let's just face it. Our mission is to do good things for people. So having a second campus allows us to do more good things for more people. It's like it's sort of a no-brainer. So it is our mission, and obviously given Mrs. Chadwick's view of the world, I mean, she wrote in Dipperful of Humanity that she did think there should be more Chadwick schools in the desert, in the mountains, and in other countries. Second was to improve our knowledge and expertise in our educational program through collaboration and alignment across the campuses. I gave you the image of the rock climbing. It's a process that makes us think about what we're doing and why we're doing it. Let's face it, for a school that aspires to be world class, to have a second campus in a country that is so focused on and passionate about education as South Korea is an amazing advantage for us as we build the program. And over there, as you know, we run the International Baccalaureate program in the Village School. That's the gold standard amongst international schools. So to match up an elite American independent school program with one that is an elite international school program, and to have those teachers communicate with each other and work together so that now we don't have two first grade teachers, we have four. Two of them are here and two of them are in South Korea. And to have them collaborating, seeing where we can align, seeing where we can't align, seeing where things don't match up, where it doesn't make sense. Just as in one Algebra 1 class, it may not make sense to spend the amount of time on something that the other Algebra 1 class is doing. But having that conversation ongoing is a tremendous advantage for the school in terms of moving our program forward. The International Baccalaureate, I would encourage you to go to IBO.com and look at their website. But basically, these core competencies that we have are very much similar to what is the International Baccalaureate program is all about. And now, as they get ready to move to an International Baccalaureate in grades 6 through 10 and then to the diploma program 11 through 12, Chadwick teachers are going to be involved in working with them as to how to put that program together in ways where we can continue to align between the two campuses. There is a tremendous amount to be learned on this campus from what is happening at Chadwick International. So those of you who have kids in the Village School, virtually every Village teacher will be spending a week in South Korea this year in order to learn from the teachers over there, quite honestly. Because last year we spent the year in the Village studying inquiry and how to teach using an inquiry approach. That is the basis of the International Baccalaureate program. So we're basically going as observers to understand how to do this so that we can form relationships that will benefit our program, not just this year, but for years to come. It's an amazing opportunity. Technology is another aspect. You're probably aware that CI is a one-to-one technology starting in the first grade. We're not. We started with iPads in the fifth grade and we're going into the sixth grade. We have a lot to learn. The fact that we're also now using Skype and other means to bring teachers together is great. And telepresence, we're learning a lot. A second major reason that we benefit from having a second campus is building relationships. Chad Detloff spoke eloquently, I think, about the global opportunities. But the global opportunity of having, let's say you're a kindergartner, somebody that you get to know over 13 years through telepresence, and then maybe occasionally you guys get to actually do something together, that's wonderful. We think about where the world's going to be. If our kids are equipped to deal with kids from other cultures, to understand them, to appreciate them, and they're not even out of the Village School yet, what a great gift is that to the kids. And the same thing is true with the faculty members. It gives our kids something that's really, really hard to replicate. So this year, for example, you're going to see all kinds of collaborations between our faculty and the CI and PV faculty and kids. Here's some examples. So Chad mentioned the combined trip to Nepal with the Interact group of Rotary. Robotics, planning and competing together. We're talking about maybe a city planning joint class in the spring, using the telepresence to teach it, and using Songdo, the city that's still being built, as a model. We are working together on the 6 through 12 humanities sequences and courses. We're aligning the programs in the global languages. Both art departments have adopted this Dipper Full of Humanity. They're making dippers on both campuses, I guess, for the art. So some of them are important, and some of them are just ways to get people together. You know, you could say this is not core, but it's just a way for kids to work together. Last year, you saw the Battle of the Books in the fourth grade. There are book clubs in the seventh grade. They're going to do Korean and U.S. stock exchange projects in the sixth grade. Kevin Babuder is talking about a course made up of videos of kids singing on both campuses. I thought you had to be in the same place to sing together, but I was wrong. There are lots and lots of pen pals. We're talking about a two-campus speaker series. So this year, I think you're going to see lots and lots of opportunities for the kids to collaborate. Some of those are academic in nature, and some of them are just for the purpose of building relationships so that the kids get to know each other. The third major benefit to Chadwick and Palos Verdes is the enhancing and spreading of Chadwick's reputation. Blair Horner referred to it in his speech. It's already happened. I mean, we get called upon to speak at various places now. The Chadwick name is well known. We were approached by, you know, we talked to Khan Academy. Some of you know them. They're very interested in us because we have, you know, we're one of the few schools that has two campuses. The National Association of Independent Schools, we're now sort of regular speakers there on global education. We were invited to join the World Leading Schools Association, which not only has 50 of the top Chinese schools, but also Eton, which is a place I'm very interested in since they've turned out 16 prime ministers. I'd like to know what it is they're doing over there. At any rate, it helps us to differentiate ourselves from other schools and our graduates from kids from other schools. Certainly, as I said, being in Korea is a tremendous opportunity for us, given where the future is headed. And then, so as I said, if you're trying to be world class, having a high performing second campus in a very, very advanced, educationally focused country is a huge advantage in ways that we are only beginning in year three to take advantage of, but already I think it's been very meaningful. And then there's the open-mindedness. One of the things that I really love is the open-mindedness and ambition of our faculty, parents, staff, students. I mean, you could say, well, we're a really good school. We've been here for 77 years or whatever. We should rest on our laurels, just keep doing what we're doing. And I'm really excited that we don't do that. Obviously, CI is a huge example of that. But we already play leadership roles in Round Square. We were one of 15 schools around the world invited to participate in the AP Capstone program, which is, you know, where the APs are going. And I'm really pleased that under Mark Wiedemann's tutelage, our students scored among the highest of the 15 the students of the 15 schools that participated. So we pretty much hit that out of the park. We're asked to speak, you know, all over the place. We've been able to attract people like Deborah Dowling, who, you know, is, you know, works with other organizations. Megan Holmstrom, you also heard referred to, works with LA County and LMU to train math leaders. You heard Nigel Williams spoken of. I mean, I can't imagine there are too many people in the world more dynamic and a more talented and I don't even know what to say, able director of, what's that? Smashingly brilliant. If you haven't met Nigel, you definitely should, and encourage your kids to take his class or prep for the play. And then Bruce Pock. You know, 25 years as the director of admissions and vice president of Pomona College, I can say as somebody who was in college counseling for a while, probably one of the three or four most outspoken, most articulate, most quoted, most well-known people in college admissions in the country. And we were delighted to have him join Chadwick last year, and now this year, as you know, he's overseeing both admissions and college counseling. But, you know, having a Bruce Pock gives us a huge, huge opportunity, not only in terms of getting the right messages out to colleges, but all and to people as young as four, but also to making sure that our program is really doing what it needs to do to prepare our kids for the future and for the places where they want to go next. Of course, we've added, you know, the integrated science that Deb talked about and some of the other things. But what I really like is, as much as we've done in recent years, we still have the opportunity and the will to move forward, to model the core competencies as a school. The core competencies aren't just for the kids, they're for all of us. And we have to all demonstrate these things. I have to tell you, one of the things I'm most happy about is that courage made it onto the list. because I completely agree with Deb said. You know, it's the old thing. C.S. Lewis said, it is not a virtue in and of itself. It is every virtue at its sticking point. It is so, so important and so little discussed, as though if you just identify what's the right thing to do, it's automatically going to happen. And I'd say the vast majority of the time when it doesn't happen, it isn't because people didn't know it was right. It was that they couldn't muster the gumption to do it. It's like John Wayne said, courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway. And that's what we want our kids to do. And we see it every day. The other day I was out at cross country and I saw all of those kids running that course. It's one of the fifth or seventh or whatever most difficult course in the state of California. Every kid who went up and down those hills is demonstrating courage every single day. That young man who pulled the fire alarm is definitely is demonstrating courage by coming into my office. And then he wrote me a letter on top of that, which I will definitely frame. I will cover his name up to protect the not quite innocent. But at any rate, the fact of the matter is that drawing upon all the strengths that I've mentioned, we have the opportunity to provide kids with extraordinary learning experiences and success and failure, which, as we know, is critical to learning, profound and powerful relationships in unique and inspiring settings on our campus, on the CI campus, and off campus and around the world. I think we're already a world leader in keeping the Chadwick philosophy of experiential education that fosters independent and highly ethical thinking and action and prepares students for their future. I think we're already a world leader in doing that. But we want to do more and we want to move forward. As Michael Josephson told the faculty at before school started, you don't have to be sick to get better. I want to get to the point where every talented and good kid within driving distance of the school wants to be at Chadwick School, and where every creative, forward-looking, open-minded, child-loving teacher in the world has it as a career goal to someday get to teach at Chadwick. And I think we can do it. I'd like to close with a quote from Peter Davis in the class of 53. He said, basically what happened to me at Chadwick was that I learned to believe that all things are possible. They're not, of course, but it is nonetheless a fairly important belief, since it enables those of us who are afflicted with it to be rather persistent in trying to persuade others that the status quo is not the inevitable ordained condition of all mankind. This spirit of optimism, of idealism, of pioneering, of ambition for the common good, that's the essence of Chadwick. It infuses the place on two continents now and drives us to embrace each day with enthusiasm, wonder, and hope. So here's to a new year full of such days for all of us, children and students. Let's do what Meg said. Let's step up, let's lean in, and have a great year. Thank you.